I don't know about you, but when I first heard this song, it definitely did not sound like this. Probably like a lot of people, my first exposure to this song was at a kind of daggy blues jam session. So in my mind, I filed this song away in the kind of unflattering category, dad rock. It wasn't until years and years later when I heard this specific recording, Cream playing Crossroads from their 1968 album Wheels of Fire, that I realized I'd been so wrong. I heard this and my jaw was just glued to the ground. There was not anything remotely dad rock about it. It has this immense energy. It was faster than the daggy blues jam versions I had heard. And the bass playing, oh my goodness, it was unbelievable. I had heard the name Jack Bruce, but I had never truly appreciated his mastery until I heard this version of Crossroads. And as far as I'm concerned, the bass line in this specific recording is just a freaking masterpiece. And in this lesson, I want to decode this bass line for you, show you why it's just so colossal, and show you how you can be, you know, a little bit more Jack Bruce-ish in your own playing, if that's what you want to do. I'm also going to give you my theory about how Jack Bruce is able to do everything he does and do it just so freaking well. We'll be talking about this bassline masterpiece in chunks, but if you want the full 7-page note-for-note transcription of this bassline with the tabs, notation, and some practice tracks, then you're in luck. I've got all that stuff available as a free download on becomeabassist.com. Just click the first link in the description to grab it for yourself, and you can follow along with all the bar numbers and all that stuff. One of the very first things that struck me about this bass line is that it absolutely is full to the brim with these really independent melodic ideas that are completely, you know, independent of the guitar line. Most of the time, you know, when you go to those kind of daggy blues jam sessions that I saw when I first heard this song, the bassist would pretty much just play the exact same guitar riff over and over on every chord, but that's not what Jack Bruce does. He does do some of that, but have a listen to the bass line in the very first form. It's not until the very end of that 12 bars does he actually play that guitar riff, right? The things he plays before it, they're definitely related, but they're still independent of what the guitar is doing. And not just independent, but super cool ideas as well. They are, you know, interesting enough in their own right that if you were just to listen to the bass line, it would still be super cool, super satisfying. This bass line is just full of these really catchy Jack Bruce ideas. Some of my favorite ones are at bars 109 to 112. He's fully bending here, like an electric guitarist would do. Massive blues influence here. What a total badass, right? Now, in terms of what he actually plays for these independent ideas, he leans pretty heavily a lot of the time on the minor pentatonic or the blues scale. In this case, we're in A, so it's a lot of A blues scale, A minor pentatonic scale. Check out some other cool, really, you know, melodic ideas at bars 67 and 68. Also at bar 85 to 87. All just either pure A blues scale or A minor pentatonic, but it just feels so good, right? Now, one thing I noticed about this bass line is that Jack Bruce is most improvisational, most free and doing his own thing during the guitar solos, right? Sure, he will put in, you know, a couple of licks here and there when the vocals are happening, but it's not nearly as intense or nearly as frequent as when it gets to the guitar solos. And that's true for Ginger Baker and Eric Clapton as well. And in fact, Jack Bruce has this beautiful sense of when things need to be intense and when they need to be kind of brought back. Have a look at what he plays over the final 12-bar form. We've just come from this super intense guitar solo, but Jack Bruce just brings it all back down to earth with just a very relatively simple pumping eighths line. He knows exactly how and when to be supportive and how and when exactly he's got the freedom to do what he wants. It's incredible. So if you want to start sounding a bit more and playing a bit more like Jack Bruce, start thinking in terms of independent melodic ideas that use the blues or the minor pentatonic scales, but make sure you do your best to pick your moments when you go off script. You don't want to be trampling on anyone's toes, right? Now, this recording is just a straight up 12-bar blues in the key of A. Of course, the original was the Robert Johnson Crossroads, which was slightly different than the Cream version, obviously, but the Cream version is just a straight up 12-bar blues. So we're just using an A7 chord, D7 chord, and then an E7 chord as well. But what Jack Bruce displays over and over and over again is this really, really deep understanding of the harmony of the chords, and he plays around with them in some really, really cool ways. Now, in a regular A blues, in the turnaround, you have an E7 chord going to the D7 chord and then resolving to that A7 chord right there. You know, most of the time, that's exactly what Jack Bruce will do. He'll outline some kind of E idea, then some kind of idea based around D, and then back to A. Every once in a while, though, he goes off script. He does something a little bit different, which sounds super, super cool. He'll play E's over the E chord, pretty straightforward, but then over the D chord, instead of playing a D, he'll actually play an F sharp. He does it in three separate places in this song, in bars 22, 34, and 70. Doing this effectively creates a D over F sharp chord, or D7 over F sharp. A D chord or a D7 chord in what's called first inversion. So that F sharp, it's part of the chord, so it's not like he's breaking any rules or anything, it just means he's not playing the root of the chord. But have a listen to what it does in the moment. Instead of having this kind of falling thing that you would normally find in a 12-bar blues, you get a kind of lifting feeling instead. You get... super, super cool. And as soon as I figured out what he was doing here, I started experimenting with this idea, tried to put it into my own playing as much as I could. It's a ton of fun. There are plenty of other places where Jack Bruce demonstrates his, you know, mastery of the chords, mastery of the harmony. One of his favorite tricks to do is to play the root of the chord, you know, for example, A, and then go down to the third, and then walk up chromatically. So for some examples of that, check out bars 53 to 56. Notice as well that even though there's a C natural in the guitar riff, that C natural there, Jack Bruce knows that the chord is actually an A7, and that the chord itself has a C sharp in it rather than a C natural. So he's more than happy to play that note in there. The same kind of idea happens at bar 113. It's similar to the last one, right? One other slightly sneaky thing that he does is he basically controls in the first four bars whether to put a D chord in the second bar. Sometimes he does just by playing ideas around the D in that second bar. And of course, sometimes he just plays straight through. I don't think this is an accident though. I think he knows exactly what he's doing and just plays what he's hearing at that point in time. Throughout this whole song, Jack Bruce is in extreme, supreme control of the harmony. So if you want your playing to sound a bit more like Jack Bruce, really getting to know the chords of the songs you're playing, get to know all your options beyond the root note is a great idea. One of the main things that really captured my imagination with this recording though is just how it feels. There's this kind of edge to it that is unbelievably exciting. It's maybe, you know, a little bit faster than most of the, you know, the daggy versions I'd heard before I stumbled upon this recording, but it's, you know, it's about more than just the speed. It's the time feel and the, you know, intensity where Jack Bruce kind of sits in the groove and how he treats the rhythms that he uses. To my ear, there's three main ingredients he uses here in terms of the time feel. Number one, he's on the bleeding edge of the beat. Number two, he generally uses shorter notes. And number three, he'll often play strings of offbeat notes or kind of little stabs of 16ths. Now, when I say number one, he's on the bleeding edge of the beat, I mean he's right at the edge where he isn't rushing. He's not, you know, speeding up, essentially, but he's really pushing forward on the time. He's leaning forward in the groove. It's kind of like the exact opposite of what you might find in like a reggae bass line, which would lean back in the groove. Using shorter notes, number two, like he does, it gives that same kind of feeling of lurching forward into space. And having strings of offbeat notes or lines of 16ths also has that exact same effect. So these three things, they really work together to give this incredible feeling of momentum in the bass line. And probably the best example of this in the whole bass line is probably from bars 65 to 68. This was probably the moment for me that really kind of blew my mind when I first heard it. He has really gone for it, and it just feels really incredible to me. This line checks all three boxes. It's really pushing on the time, the notes are short, and they're offbeat. There's this rhythmic idea that lasts 3/16ths, but he's only playing on the first two, so there's this 16th note rest there. So he's getting the... You know, he's so on top of everything, and on top of that, that amazing kind of polyrhythmic stuff going on as well. This one line is like a microcosm of this idea of Jack Bruce's unrelenting rhythm. He is really pushing on the groove the whole time he's playing. So if you want to sound more like Jack Bruce, do these three things. Push on the time a little bit, lean forward, use shorter notes most of the time, and play either strings of offbeats or add in small subdivisions into the lines that you're playing. We have to talk about tone, because the sound that comes forth from Jack's bass is just so, so heavy. Now, some people disagree. They don't actually like the sound on this particular recording. But for me, that overdriven, super aggressive sound, it absolutely works for me. It also makes it, you know, relatively easy to hear exactly what he's doing in the recording, right? It's even easier to hear his tone on the other track recorder from this same show as Crossroad, a track called Spoonful. Have a listen to this one. Now, as far as specific gear that Jack Bruce was known to use around that time, his Gibson EB3 was probably what he was playing on this recording, and likely his live setup, which was, you know, a bunch of 100-watt Marshall stacks that were overdriven. And apparently, he would totally max out the gain when he played with them as well. Very rock and roll. There's an interview where he says that around that time he was using lighter gauge labella strings, which makes sense, right? With a lighter gauge, you can do all those cool guitaristic bends and stuff like that. It'd be harder with medium strings, I guess, but not impossible. In fact, I've got medium strings on this bass, you know. It's still possible, but, you know, on lighter gauge strings, they're real bendy, really loose, really fun to play around with. It is more about just the gear, though. It's also about how Jack Bruce plays, his entire approach to playing. The sound is very aggressive, and the part that's probably even more important than the gear is that he's being super aggressive with his technique. He's really digging into the strings with his right hand, getting a ton of attack even before the sound gets processed by his amp. Now, unfortunately, there's no video of this actual recording, but check out his right hand at this gig from Revolution Club. He's really getting in there, right? You know, maybe that's just so the volume would be higher, but more than likely it's to get that super aggressive, overdriven sound directly from the fingers first, and then use the amp to simply enhance that kind of aggressive tone. So if you want your tone to be a little bit more Jack Bruce-ish, aside from emulating the gear, which will obviously help, but emulating his aggressive right hand technique is going to help a ton as well. So, where does all this come from? What can explain Jack Bruce's mastery of the harmony, playing on the bleeding edge of the beat, the super aggressive right hand technique, blistering tone, the deeply improvisational lines? What connects all of them? I think there's one thing that actually does explain a lot of this, and it's the fact that Jack was a jazz bassist playing upright bass before he switched over to electric bass. It explains so much of this amazing bass line. If you're playing jazz walking bass lines over, you know, blues and bebop tunes, like he would have been doing, you need to have, you know, knowledge of the harmony inside and out. That's likely part of the reason he knows that that D over F sharp chord is going to work and create that kind of lifting feeling. Playing jazz, he would have been needing to be playing on the leading edge of the beat. That's where the music usually feels the best, and part of what makes it feel the way it does, right? Playing upright bass, he would have also had very strong, very aggressive right hand technique, so when he came over to playing electric, that strength and force in his right hand, it just came along with him. And of course, if you're playing walking bass lines, you're always improvising, making up new things as you go along, so improvising in a rock context would have been a very natural thing for him to do. In fact, both Bruce and Baker came from a more of a jazz background, right? And Jack Bruce even said in an interview once that the approach that they took was basically a jazz approach. Ginger Baker and myself were really a hot jazz rhythm section, and even when Eric was playing, Cream was basically a jazz band. We never told Eric that, but that's another story. The approach was that of a small jazz ensemble rather than a rock band. And when you look at the bassline through that lens, it makes perfect sense. With all that said though, Cream could have been a total disaster. In general, the accepted wisdom for bass players in this kind of bluesy rock music is to keep things relatively simple and stay in the pocket, but Jack Bruce basically ignores all the rules and it still somehow works. So, why is that? Well, there's one element of Jack Bruce's playing that, at least to me, really sets him apart from so many other bassists. It's what makes this bassline work, and it is his use of repetition. Now, I've just said that throughout this whole song, he's making up new things and providing new ideas. Now, that is true, but he milks his ideas. He repeats his ideas a lot, and that does a few things. Number one, it makes the sections of the bass lines really catchy. But number two, and possibly more importantly, it gives the bass line some grounding, so it's not like the bass is constantly up in the air. At every stage of the song, Jack Bruce is still minding the shop, even when he's making up new ideas. Check out bars 45 to 46. These two bars, the rhythm is exactly the same, and the idea is basically identical. So even though he's pumping out new ideas, they're not completely unrelated. He's still repeating his ideas, and they're almost functioning as anchors. You can also look at bars 97 to 100. This is super cool, right? It's just a slight variation on the original riff, so it's still very grounding in that sense, but it's also played multiple times and then shifted over to the D chord when it comes around, right? Now that's just two of the most obvious examples, but there are so many more repeated ideas that might only last a few bars, but they add so much and also keep things from being too up in the air. We still get that foundation, right? This is the kind of stuff that makes the difference between this being amazing and captivating and, you know, just being a hot mess. Jack Bruce, he is being fancy. He's doing all kinds of crazy licks, messing with the chords, but he's still minding the shop, keeping everyone's feet on the ground through repeating rhythmic ideas as well as note ideas. Now, do you need to learn to play upright bass, master jazz and bebop and walking bass lines in order to play crossroads like Jack Bruce? Of course not. I mean, it's probably not going to hurt to do that, but it's not like it's mandatory, right? Actually, the best and fastest way to try and sound like Jack Bruce on this track, or any other song you're playing, would be to learn exactly what he played, how he played it, then internalize that as best you can, and let it permeate through your own playing. And to make that as easy as possible for you, I've got the tabs and notation of this entire bass line available as a free download, the note-for-note transcription, but I've also gone in and pitch-corrected the original recording so you can play it without having to detune your bass, and I've also got a bunch of slowed-down recordings at various speeds so you can gradually get faster and faster until you're at performance tempo with this bass line, because it is pretty intense, right? Now, again, just like the tabs and notation, the practice tracks are all completely free. Just click the first link in the description or right here, fill out the form on that page, and you could be mastering this Jack Bruce masterpiece yourself in less than 60 seconds. So I will see you in there.